Good morning and welcome to this, the 17th meeting of the European External Relations Committee in 2015. Can I make the usual request that mobile phones are switched off or on flight mode as they interfere with the sound system? Going straight in to agenda item one, we're having an EU update today from our MEPs. And with us today in the room, we have David Coburn, MEP, Ian Hudghton, MEP, and Catherine Stihler, MEP. And joining us via video conference on the monitor is Ian Duncan, MEP. Good morning and welcome to committee, everyone. Good morning. So the focus of today's evidence is obviously EU reform in the context of the committee's current work, some focus on TTIP, and some of the other issues that we're dealing with coming up in the next few months in the EU. So I'm actually going to go straight to questioning because we only have an hour this morning for this session. It's very, very tight. So I'm going to go straight to questioning. I'm going to start with my colleague, Jamie McGregor.
Thank you very much, convener. From my own region of Highlands and Islands, most of the concerns I've heard about TTIP are of an agricultural nature. And I understand that Ian Duncan recently chaired a conference on agriculture from this point of view, and that concerns are about maybe difficulties concerning the dairy side and also, or maybe positive sides on the dairy side, but more problems possibly with the suckler side. I wonder if you could possibly say what these are and also what the US opinion is, because I know that recently that you crossed the pond and heard some of their views. And I wonder if you'd like to expand on those and say whether you think that, from an agricultural point of view, that TTIP is a good thing.
Ian Duncan, would you like to comment on that? It's a direct question to you, Ian. So.
Well, it's to Ian and the rest of the panel as well.
Yeah, we'll let Ian come in first and then the rest of the panel.
Madam Convener, it's a pleasure to be here. I'm sorry I'm not with you in person, but I certainly am with you in spirit. And it's good to see the clerks in the background as well, so I wish them, I know they have done a lot of the heavy lifting today, so again, well done there. In terms of the response, I have the most serious concerns about the issue that Jamie has raised. I think right now TTIP will, to my mind, pass or fail on the basis of the wider question of agriculture and our edible goods. I have serious concerns about the way that America uses its, what I'm going to call, sub-therapeutic dosing of livestock with antibiotics. I think that is a serious danger. I don't believe we can accept that. I think that would be bad for us. I think there are so many aspects of that around the impact on what I'm going to term the biome, the human body's good bacteria, if I can say that. In terms of what's happening in the US right now, my colleague Jim Nicholson, who's a farmer from Northern Ireland and an MEP, shares my concerns. And he's of the view that this is not likely to make any serious progress at all until sometime later in 2017. So we're not going to be facing, I think, any imminent adjustments. The US election will get in the way. But again, Jimmy is right that the wider question of the quality of our goods and how they are recognized and enjoyed across the pond will be one of the important aspects. We have much to offer. And I believe if we can get the rules and regulations right about the imports, we can make some progress. But if we can't, then I would have serious reservations about TTIP as a whole. Thank you.
Into the panel.
Well, I would also like to ask that when he was in America, did he get any sort of inkling as to the timing of this and whether this could actually go through under the current presidency?
No, it will not go through under the current presidency. We really are, I think there have now been 12 rounds of bilaterals between the US and the EU. The last one took place just in Miami the other month. Progress is slow. If I were being very frank, I don't think the Americans are in any way happy with developments in the EU, and you can make of that what you will. So I think we are many years away from a conclusion to this, and many, many rounds of negotiation away from satisfactorily convincing ourselves that all is well on both sides, I believe. If you look at the level of support in the EU, it's probably much higher than it is in the US, and you'll be aware that the US is much more focused at present on the Pacific Trade Agreement, which has made far more significant progress and is truthfully more popular than TTIP is in the US itself. So no imminent progress, nothing under the current presidency. I think we are probably, well, 3 years away, 2 years certainly away from any sense of a conclusion of this, if it is concluded at all.
Thank you very much.
Ian Hudghton is nodding away. Ian, do you want to come in there?
Aye, thanks. I think we would all share concerns about Scotland's good reputation in terms of food production and supply and the standards that we have, partly due to the high standard of EU regulation for food safety and so on. But certainly in Scottish agriculture and food production, we have our geography in our favour in terms of marketing our produce as good quality, and we don't want to trade that away for anything, in my view. However, I think, you know, it's important to note what Ian Duncan said in his last few words there, that you know, nobody really knows for sure if or when TTIP will be finalised. It is not impossible that the whole thing could collapse. As you will be well aware on this committee, there is a saying in EU decision-making, nothing is agreed until everything is agreed. So at the moment, what that means is there is nothing in TTIP. There are certain chapters which have been negotiated in the various rounds of talks in which progress has been made. And as usual, they start with the easy ones in these kind of negotiations. And there are many, many areas that could lead to fairly serious difficulty in getting a final agreement, not least persuading 28 member state governments to support the outcome, plus a majority in the European Parliament. And we've had a preliminary initiative opinion on this, which set down some views which were different from what was thought to be the general drift of things at the time. That was back in July, following which the Commission brought forward what they called a modified process for to replace, according to them, for example, ISDS, one of the other big controversies. It's still not necessary, in my view, and it still will be one of the controversial areas. I don't think that we need to set up something separate between two parties which already have well-developed legal and justice systems which could cope surely with anything arising from a trade agreement. So there's a massive amount in there, but of course, from Scotland's point of view, I would expect that all of your MEPs would be uniting behind you know, seeking assurances about the key things that are important to Scotland, such as the one that that was raised.
Well, I agree a lot what Ian's been saying, and also my good friend Mr. Ian Hudghton as well. Basically, I think that TTIP is a corporatist scam designed to favour big multinational corporates against the interests of smaller businesses. I think it's very dangerous. I think the investor-state dispute, things are very, very worrying indeed. That, you know, government organisations in this country will be sued for in any way impeding some American corporations' desire to make a lot of money out of our, for example, health service and so on and so forth. Again, the agriculture situation, I think, is extremely important and, again, very frightening. And quite frankly, I'm sorry to say this, gentlemen and ladies, but it indicates the reason why Great Britain should remove itself from the European Union. We should organise our own free trade agreement. We can do it something that suits us better. Having had long-term arrangements with the United States, I'm sure we've come to a much better conclusion. Even Iceland can organise something. China can do something without having to you know, be in this situation. So the European Union is an impediment to us all. It's only interested in the views of 27 other states. One size fits all simply doesn't work. And I think that this indicates that the only way we can get out of this is to leave the European Union. So there we are.
come in on EU reform anyway, but I want to give Ms Stihler a wee chance to come in as well. We've allowed it, had everyone else speaking. I'd like you back in, and then Jamie, I can let you back in at that point.
Thank you very much, Madam Convener. I think that we all have concerns about TTIP, and as you have your mailbags, we have our mailbags too, and I think that some of the red lines on public services, ensuring that if you want to take things back into public ownership, you can do that. The issues mentioned before about secret courts, how we do not want that, and I think we all have our concerns, but as Ian says, that nothing is decided until it's decided. And at the moment, we haven't got anything to look at that we can really debate and discuss. We can talk about some of the negotiating documents that are online, that's true. So at the moment, and I think I would agree with Ian Duncan that I think this is a long way off from happening. As others have mentioned, there are presidential elections next year. But I think that what David Coburn was suggesting, that, you know, if you know that we're better out with the EU, I would firmly disagree with that analysis. I think it's better to be part of something, even if there are things that we disagree with. It's better to be in disagreeing and reforming than being out with and having things imposed on you. Thank you, Madam Convener.
Some questions on EU reform later. Jamie, do you want to come back on?
Briefly, it was quite obvious from your evidence, Mr. Coburn, that you were against, and your party were against the TTIP altogether. But don't you think that it is estimated that it will be worth $10 billion to the UK? And it also appears from financial figures that the European side will actually do better than the US side out of the deal. Don't you think it's worth really looking hard at it before dismissing it as you do?
No. Certainly not, because I think it's not just that, it's the entire European Union itself and the entire principle of it. We should be dictating our own TTIP treaty. We could come to a much better arrangement than the European Union ever could. And quite frankly, it said it would take about a decade to get 0.5% improvement in GDP out of it. And the gains are too small to be accurately measured. Quite honestly, I think the whole thing is a mess. It's been negotiated in secret. Nobody knows what's going on. I think the whole thing is wrong. I think we are much better negotiating it from our own standpoint. And I'm sure farmers and everybody else in this country equally agree that we'd rather negotiate our own trade treaty with the United States. We're perfectly capable of doing it. And I can't see any advantage to having it changed and chopped up and made to suit the Spanish or the French or the Germans or somebody else. We organise our own trade treaty and we'll do a lot better out of it. Also, the European Union is intrinsically socialist. So, quite frankly, it's not in our best interest. We are a go-getting capitalist country. Let's go get them. Let's be capitalist. Why should we be shackled to a dying European Union, which is not a good trading organisation? It's falling to bits. It's something out of the 1950s. We really don't need it. We've got free trade worldwide now. Let's get on with that. We should do our own trade and organise our own trade treaty.
Yes.
Okay,
all right.
Thank you. Willie Coffey.
Thanks very much. I wonder if I could ask about your views on recent public opinion polls on the matter of the UK and Scotland's membership of the European Union. As recently as yesterday, a poll showed that when you exclude the don't knows, 74% of the Scottish people favour remaining in the European Union. But as recently as September, another poll showed that when you exclude the don't knows, 52% of those across the UK favoured leaving the European Union. What's your party's views on this? As Scottish representatives, do you think that if Scotland votes yes to stay in, but across the UK they vote to leave, should Scotland be pulled out of the European Union on the back of UK no votes?
Even from the start, I dispute those.
Sure. I think that the poll that we all saw, I think yesterday, of 65% was very, very encouraging. And I think that, but as we know with polls, that the only poll that counts will be when that referendum date is. And at the moment, we don't know when that is. We know that the Prime Minister has now come forward with the four asks, and that will go to, I think, the December Council. So I think the sooner that we know a date of the referendum, the better for all of us. And I think that we have to wait, and any of us that are pro us remaining in the European Union have to work together to ensure that that happens. It's of great benefit to Scottish businesses, Scottish consumers, And I think that the uncertainty, anything that would happen to our membership of the European Union at the moment, whether that's on agricultural policy and payments or in structural funds, and I know this committee has been looking at those things. So I think that we've got a big job ahead of us, but it's a campaign that I will be fighting very much on the different side from Mr. Coburn of us, the benefits that we have of remaining part of the European Union.
Thank you, Mr. Coburn.
Well, I dispute those figures entirely. The other recent polls have pointed out the difference between Scotland and England in terms of views of the European Union are very much the same. Slightly more in favour in Scotland than in England, but much the same. And, you know, I've knocked on doors in both countries, and quite frankly, the views are the same. People are slightly more in favour in Scotland, but not much. It's not in Scotland's interest to discuss this any further in terms of a breakup of the UK. Quite frankly, we decided that. That's what we had the referendum for, and that was decided once and for all. So we're in or out on the basis of the, together. When we went into the European Union in the first place, the deal was we went in together, so therefore the deal will be we have to leave together. And if it was any other way, what Scotland will have to do is reapply, and it will have to wait for probably 5 years and come in after Turkey. So I don't think that's even credible. And I got that from Mr. Juncker himself, and that was on television, it was televised. So, you know, it's not in Scotland's best interests to be different from England in this. We do more business with England than we do with anybody else. So would we want an international border at Gretna Green? I really don't think so. It's not Scotland's business interest. And we should stop talking about this rubbish, because it's harming Scottish business. And I'm a businessman, many years standing. I talk to businessmen all the time. And businessmen in Scotland do not want to leave England or be apart from England and be part of the European Union. That's a nonsense.
Okay. Ian Hudghton.
I think Willie Coffey was referring to an actual scientific opinion poll that was publicised yesterday, which did in fact produce the results that he indicated. And at this stage, I think that is encouraging, as someone who's from a party who is positive in terms of Scotland's opportunities through EU membership and indeed our actual benefits right now. I look forward to a positive campaign in the referendum whenever it comes. But it is, I think, at the same time, reasonable if we do have significant differences in opinion between the partner. Remember, we are equal partners and respected, apparently, in this UK union, that if there are different views amongst the nations of currently making up the UK Union, then they should be respected. And I don't think it is reasonable for Scotland to be taken out of the European Union in a referendum if there is a significant difference and a vote in favour in Scotland. And you yourself have documents in your agenda pack today which itemise the many positives arising from EU membership. I mean, one of the negatives is often referred to as connected with fisheries, but even in that, the market, the EU market, is very important for 75% of Scotland's seafood exports by value, according to your own research documents. So there are massive practical benefits that I think we would do well to consider as we are working towards this referendum.
Ian Duncan.
At the very fact that Ian Hudghton used the word scientific opinion poll, I think in the last suite of opinion polls before the last election, we've recognised that the science is a little bit shaky. I think an artistic opinion poll might be the better description. When you see the polling taken around here, I think it's interesting. If you talk about in-out as simple yes, no, you can get certain results. But when you look at the polling with the word reformed EU in there, you begin to find a different result. And my feeling right now is north and south of the border, and frankly, on this side of the channel, on the other side of the channel, people really do want serious reform. And I'm very conscious that that's what we need to be talking about today, because I don't believe one single person you've got before you today believes the EU is doing it exactly right. We want to see it done better. We want to see it more efficient, more effective. We want to make sure that when we go round the doors, we're able to say to people, it's a good thing if it works well. the challenge we've got now is how to deliver upon that reform. And in terms of the direct points made by Mr. Coffey, I don't see this happening. I see Scotland as a principal beneficiary of being in the EU when it works well, but I've seen too many things. I think all of you around that table will have seen many, many examples where the EU seems distant or remote or out of touch. And when we do talk indeed about the TTIP discussions, and you look at the vote inside the European Parliament, there were actually only three countries' MEPs voted against the TTIP provision. The UK was one, France was another, and Greece was another. Every single other one voted in support of it, even with the very issues which some of you have said, the ISDS and so on, are anathema and are wrong. Now, I don't wish to give Mr. Coburn too much credit here, but the reality does indeed remain that our ability, even if every single MEP from the United Kingdom voted against TTIP, our ability to be outside of it would be heavily restricted by our membership of the EU. Now, you may make of that what you will. My argument is we need to push for serious reform of TTIP, but be under no illusions that when we talk about these things, there's a great appetite across Eastern Europe, certainly, Central Europe, certainly, and Southern Europe for TTIP to go forward. And I think the reality remains that although France and indeed Great Britain are against that, our ability to influence will be restricted by our membership of the EU. Now, I like TTIP. I think it will work. I think it will deliver for Scotland. I think it will make people, I think it will grow jobs. I think it will grow the economy. So I think, to my mind, that is one of the great potential achievements of the European Union. When I speak to people on the doorstep, I say right now, if we can increase trade, if we can make trade better, we can grow jobs. And frankly, the EU, I think, has been too sclerotic in its approach to this. We should be looking at trade agreements also with places like India. India is the single largest drinker of whiskey, but doesn't drink scotch. We can't export there. The tariffs are 150%. Imagine if we could get a trade agreement that eliminated the tariffs. Imagine what that would mean for the glens of Scotland. You would suddenly see distilleries springing up, having to feed what would be a bountiful market. The EU should be focusing upon these aspects, rather than, as it often does, intrinsic navel-gazing. And I think that's part of the problem. It's harder to sell the EU when the EU itself is not always its best friend. Thank you.
To bring Rod Campbell in, because he wants to expand on the TTIP question, and I think if we do that now, that's a very good time to do it, and then I'll bring Willie back in after that. Sorry, Willie.
Okay. Sorry about this panel, but I just wanted to recap a little bit on TTIP, and just to talk a little bit about the Trans-Pacific Partnership. I don't know whether the panel would agree that that's could be considered as the big brother of TTIP. There seems to be increasingly political opposition to that in both the Senate and the House of Representatives, and more particularly from a key presidential candidate, Hillary Clinton, who said that she is now opposed to it and would not support it if elected as president. Do the panel agree that if TPP fails, there's no prospect of TTIP being agreed with the USA? That was my first point on TTIP.
Ian, do you want to come in, Catherine?
Yeah, I think that there's something in that. If indeed that turns out to be the case, if the US, having prioritised along with the Pacific, other Pacific countries, that partnership, then subsequently didn't support it for any reason, then I think it would put TTIP in a different light as far as the US side of the negotiations are concerned. I think that is right. But just briefly back to some of the points that Ian Duncan was making. I don't think, in the broad debate about EU membership that anyone is saying that the EU is perfect or is not in need of reform. But in my view, a lot of the problems that we have had as a member state, and for the moment, the UK is the member state, have been caused by the attitude of UK governments and how they operate within the European Union. And that goes right back to, it is true, and if it goes right back to the fact that a UK government, took us into the common fisheries policy, which was a total disaster against the interests of the UK's and Scotland's fishing communities, deliberately negotiating it away. Now,
Ian Duncan, I'll let you come back in, Ian Duncan, but it's really difficult to try and manage if people are shouting over each other. So if you I'll be patient and I will let you back in. Ian Hudghton, if you can continue.
Whereas, if you look at member states who have continuously acted positively within the framework of EU negotiation on behalf of their own interests, then by and large they have a different result and a different attitude and a different perception on the part of their people as to what how useful EU membership has been to them. And that comes right up to today. Instead of the current UK government working within the frameworks that are available in order to reform or change things or to defend their own interests, they have to take this sort of grumpy, standoffish attitude, change these four things in some strangely unspecified way, or risk losing us. It's not exactly a skillful negotiating tactic if what you actually want is to achieve these changes and to generally improve how the European Union works. Far better to work constructively from within, as the other member states are doing.
Ian Duncan, do you want to come back in then, and then I'll go to David Coburn and then Catherine.
Yes, I do. I think that is a mistaken analysis, frankly. I think the UK does have a solid reputation and is very constructive. And if you listen to much of the mood music just now, the greater concern in the EU is that the UK might leave and thereby change the balance that has taken place within the European Union. But I am struck again of how constructive the Conservative Party, the Conservative government, can be. Last week, for example, there was an attempt in the European Parliament to have an emergency debate on the steel question. Now, right now, the Parliament in Scotland, this is a big issue. You've been pushing very strongly. I know people around that table have been pushing very strongly. The SNP MEPs, one did not attend, and one voted against the emergency debate. Now, frankly, if you're talking about constructive engagement here, actually, that was a live issue, an important issue, an issue that I know and Ms. Stihler and indeed Mr. Coburn are passionate about, and indeed I know Mr. Hudghton is passionate about, and we were almost there to have a debate, and actually it didn't happen. So sometimes you've got to be constructive both at home and abroad.
Mr. Coburn.
Well, let's be honest about it. The European Union is totally unreformable. Mr. Cameron has put forward some pathetic fig leaves to try and cover his enormous embarrassment. And quite frankly, he's not getting anywhere and he's not going to get any of it. One of the biggest problems, of course, is free movement of labour throughout the European Union. This is a disaster, and we've seen what's been happening recently, which has made it even more of a live topic. But as regards the fishing, I don't understand the SNP claim to be a nationalist party for Scotland. Well, in Scotland's best interest to get out of the European Union and get our fishing back. You know, let's get 200-mile limits back. Let's use our own seas, rebuild our fishing fleets, and have canning factories and processing works for seafood. Seafood is a major industry in the world, and the Spanish are making absolute mint out of it, and we are not getting anything out of it. They're raiding our seas. So, you know, how the SNP can claim to be a nationalist party when they're quite happy to give away our fishing to the Spanish. It seems insane to me. And I believe the Scottish National Party are not a nationalist party. They are an international socialist party.
Can we just stick to topic,
they are purely interested in the European Union. They are a pro-Europe party. If you want to get out of the European Union, the only party to vote for, I'm afraid, in this election is UKIP, because the Conservatives, Ruth Davidson, says she'll sign up to anything that Cameron brings back from Europe.
Okay.
So it's unreformable. It's utter nonsense. You can't reform it. 27 other countries, and they've said, quite frankly, they're not going to change anything. And Madam Merkel has said the same thing.
I think it's very, very clear that my definition of nationalist is very different from yours, Mr. Coburn. Catherine?
Yes, probably.
Mr. Campbell's question about TTP. I think it's a bit more complex than that. I think there's politics at play in the States at the moment with the presidential election coming up. I think that perhaps one Mr. Sanders' comments about being anti it led to another candidate's comments about being anti TTP. So I think that there's a long way to go to draw parallels. But I think it is interesting about the trade debate and where it's at. And I think that we have to wait and see. The TTIP debate is ongoing. The negotiations, I think the last round was in Miami in October, so we have to see how those negotiations and keep monitoring and looking at what is going on with those. As for the broader reform debate, I mean, we are going to be faced with a choice. There will be a referendum. We don't know when. Some people are speculating it may be April. people are speculating it might be June. We just don't know. But what we do know is there will be a referendum before the end of 2017, and people will have a choice. And I think the choice of the British people is very clear, that I think it's best to remain in and reform the European Union. I disagree completely with David Coburn's analysis that you can't reform things. I think you can, and we've seen that quite clearly in the better regulation agenda that's going on at the moment, and what we're trying to do about the digital single market, and what we're trying to do to make the single market work more efficiently and effectively, which helps both businesses, consumers and individuals, and also about jobs and growth. So there's so much there that we have to consider. So I think these are questions that we will have to debate and discuss, but it will be a choice, and we have to, I think those who want us to remain in as part of the European Union have to put those arguments across very vociferously. Thanks.
Thank you.
Can I just have a second question on TTIP, then I'll shut up about TTIP. Can I just refer to an article which was in The Economist, that radical magazine last month, which said that the deal's fuzzy nature makes credible economic forecasts hard. Opposition has been fiercest in Germany and Austria, two countries with strong social systems and low rates of unemployment. Lots to lose and not much to gain, critics would say. So now TTIP supporters are emphasising two related strategic arguments. First, TTIP will cement the alliance between the world's great democratic powers at an unstable time. Some speak of an economic NATO. Second, establishing common or mutually recognised standards in the world's two largest consumer markets will oblige the rest of the world to follow suit, even on such matters as labour and human rights. Comments?
One of the debates we had in the Internal Market Committee was on standards, and there was a great feeling that perhaps this could create a single market across the Atlantic, that we could create a single set of standards and all of this. And there was a presentation given, and then very quickly, 6 months later, we were given the presentation that there wasn't going to be as much cooperation in standards at that moment. And there was a kind of disappointment about that. But I think that the article you quote, obviously these negotiations, I can tell you what my red lines are, which are about public services. I think many of us share those concerns, although to be fair to the Commission and the chief negotiator, they say that public services are protected, but you can't tell anything until you see the final text. So, I mean, but as we've said, there's a long, long way to go. I think that's an interesting Economist article. I think the thing that maybe you should be looking at, which we will be voting on, is CETA, and that's coming up. We again don't know the exact date, but I would think that that would be something that the committee might want to reflect upon about what is in that, and we will be having a yes-no vote on that agreement. As for TTP, I don't serve in the Trade Committee, but I do think that these debates are important, and we know from our constituent mailbags that people are very, very concerned about this, and rightly so.
One of the things that we realised very quickly about CETA is and Jamie McGregor, it's one he has, furrows he's been ploughing for a long time, is about the named brands, the famous brands, and you know that being sort of ignored in the CETA agreement. So hopefully lessons would be learned on that. Yeah. Any other comments on that question, Ian?
Yeah, I think a speculative, if you like, article that does outline some of the potential big benefits of a sensible TTIP, but because we don't know what eventually is going to be in it, we can't exactly say, you know, yeah, that's how it would be, for all kinds of reasons. And Catherine's referred to red lines, and you know, the vote that we had in July in the European Parliament that has been referred to a couple of times, it wasn't for or against TTIP particularly, although there were amendments set down to suggesting that the negotiations should be suspended, and I voted for these on the grounds that it would be better to suspend them, sort out how the process is going, make it more public and so on, and then resume. But red lines like protection of health services, and particularly the public administration of these, we're told, both by the UK government and by the commissioner responsible, that there is no threat to the health service. Well, just write that in then, and we will not have a problem, you know. So we really need to see what is in the text before we can say it's a good or a bad thing. In principle, there are trading advantages that can be speculated about, but on the other hand, if the negotiations are carried out in such a secretive way and they've been gradually been dragged a little bit more into the open, then you can't help kind of understanding that people will be suspicious about what's going on.
Yeah. Ian Duncan on The Economist article.
good in parts, I think, is probably the best description of it. A couple of things that are worth flagging up, and Catherine is exactly right. The vote, the series vote on CETA, will be where we begin to see the plates shifting or not, and it already has the ISDS clause within it. I think right now the work which the Commission has done to reform that has been fairly substantial, and I think that's important. Does it go far enough? No, I think it can go further. And I think that's where we in the European Parliament have been able to apply pressure. But we have to recognise that we apply pressure in sometimes the oddest of ways. We are not a negotiator on this treaty. We are a final sanction on it. We will vote for or against it. But we have to really try and use whatever clout we can to encourage the Commission, when appropriate, to think again. And in terms of the, as you, Madam Convener, were raising the issues around the protection of brands, the protection of quality produce from Scotland, I know the UK and Scottish Government have been working hand in hand, so I've been speaking to both of them about this, and that's important, because we've got to recognise that we're not diminishing or losing from what is going to take place. And in terms of the vote on TTIP, that was, to me, a very frustrating occasion, because the debate itself, in many respects, was informed by misinformation more than information. And certainly, I'm sure that all of the MEPs, and no doubt many of the MSPs, will have mailbags full of information. And I had to spend quite a bit of time, and you can go onto my website and find the response I sent out that went through, it was by the end, about 10 pages we had to go through to explain every single aspect of it, especially where errors were made. ISDS, I think, does need to be reformed, but I also am aware that it is being reformed, and I think that's a useful thing to see. In terms of the bigger question about the harmonisation, I make a simple point, which is right now life-saving drugs created in the US cannot be marketed here until they've gone through exactly the same procedures to test their safety in the European Union. Wouldn't it be great if the life-saving drugs in the US could be used here the moment they pass there? And the same thing in reverse, when life-saving drugs are created in the EU, that they can be used in the US. That should not be beyond the ken of clever men and women. Surely we should be able to get to that stage. Perhaps this is an area where we can be pushing again. Why not? We are fully aware that the pharmaceuticals in the US are significant. Let's make sure that when there are breakthroughs, that we all benefit on both sides of the Atlantic. That would seem sensible.
Thank you. Mr. Coburn, have you got a response to the Economist
again,
article?
Again, as I said, that we don't know exactly what's in it, so it's all been done as secret, so it's a bit of a problem. Basically, I still go back to what I said before. With Britain itself would make a better trade deal with the United States than we could ever get out of Europe. They're not very good at this sort of thing, and it's biased towards France and Germany. It basically gives an unfair advantage to large corporations, and TTIP is a lobbyist dream. So I just think we'd be better off doing it ourselves.
Okay, Catherine.
David, have you actually gone to the room and read the documents that we now have access to? I know it's not the biggest start, but it is a start to actually be able to go and look at the documents where before we were denied that. I certainly have. I don't know if you have.
My colleagues have. Sure,
but I would urge you to, as an individual, to go and have a look.
It's so difficult to do. They make it so impossible.
No, well,
it's Stuart Agnew spent a great deal of time doing it.
Mr. Coburn, can we come back to the point of our committee inquiry today? Willie Coffey, you want to pick up where you left off?
Thank you.
I've got Hans Aller next.
Yeah, thanks very much. It seems so long ago when I asked the question. Should Scotland vote yes to stay in and the UK votes no to come out? What's your respective party views? And Mr. Hudghton and Mr. Coburn made their views clear. So I don't need a response from them to help the committee, but I wasn't so clear when Mrs. Stihler and Mr. Duncan's responses. Should Scotland vote yes to stay in and the UK votes to come out? What should happen?
Do you want me to? I mean, I think that you predict different scenarios in all of this. I believe that we're part of the United Kingdom, and if we're making a decision as part of the UK on this issue to remain in. So I think that before we can speculate whatever result will happen, I think that we have to join forces to ensure that we do remain in the European Union. And we mentioned about agriculture and structural funds, also about research funding to Scottish universities as well. It's absolutely pivotal that we remain in. So I think that what will happen here, what will happen in other parts, I think we have to work together to remain in the European Union.
Does that mean Scotland should leave if Scotland votes yes and the UK votes no?
Well, you're making an assumption. I think we have to wait. No, I'll give you a straight answer. I think we have to make sure. I think we have to make sure when we see the poll that happens, which will be on that day, that instead of speculating about what person will do and what person will not do, I think we have to work together to ensure that we remain part of the European Union because it's in Scotland's best interest to do so.
Yes, I'm very happy to answer that. Mr. Coffey's being a little bit devilish, I imagine. I think we're all fully aware that this issue was very widely covered during the referendum. I'm under no illusion that I've spoken it many, many times. So the Scottish constituency, the Scottish voters, were fully aware of that. And the one thing I think we can all rejoice in is that Scotland is a remarkably informed body politic. So, in truth, well, they answered that question and did it quite clearly in that referendum. But to make a separate point, if I may, it's very easy to say, well, if England votes to leave and Scotland votes to stay, why don't we change it around? What if Northern Ireland votes to leave and Scotland and England and Wales vote to stay? There are complexities here, no doubt, if you wish to make those sorts of points. But again, as Catherine says, we are the United Kingdom. And the one part of that which has been asked about whether they wish to remain part of the United Kingdom is Scotland, and he answered, yes, they do. And so that, I think, was well aired during that particular discussion. Very well aired indeed.
Still none the wiser.
OK. Hans-Ala.
Thank you very much. And I have to say that Catherine and Ian Duncan have answered several of my questions already, so thank you very much for that. I just want to ask one question, but I also want to make one point. That's to David Coburn, and that is that we have business women as well in Scotland. I know he spends a lot of time in Brussels, and there may not be as many business women there. You say businessmen. I can assure you we have...
So if
you'll allow me to finish, please. I allowed you to finish. And to say that, you know, not to say that there's British... there's business women in Scotland is very unreasonable. They're very successful, and I welcome that they are joining more and more businesses. I just wanted to make that point. But I also want to ask one point from the panel, if I may, and that is that we in Scotland, particularly in rural areas, have a problem in terms of broadband facility that is not being made available. Will TTIP help us in that avenue at all? Is that going to be in the frame? Is any discussions taken part to see if we will benefit from that at all? Because I haven't seen anything yet.
Digital. Who knows about digital? Catherine.
The whole, well, obviously in Scotland we've got the 85% commitment that, and that is fantastic, but what about the other 15%? I think that's the big challenge. I think in the digital single market strategy, we saw clearly that, you know, everything's digital. You know, the single market is the digital single market. And I know that in your report you talked about the new proposal that's about upgrading the single market as well, but everything is interlinked. So if we can get the digital single market to work effectively, you're looking like, what is it, $250 billion worth of growth. You're looking at the fact that that's obviously preparing for not just the future, but the current industrial the third industrial revolution that we're experiencing in. So in the digital single market strategy, obviously we've just approved the telecoms package. We're going to relook at telecoms as well, which is where the broadband infrastructure is. To be fair, Hansela, that's the whole issue about infrastructure is debated in the industry committee rather than the internal market committee, but everything's interrelated. But I think, I mean, you're absolutely right about, I think the digital single market falls into kind of three areas. It's about accessibility, it's about skills, and it's about mindset. And on accessibility, it's not just about the affordability, it's actually making sure that people have access to this. And there's some fantastic models in Scotland. If you go to, I mean, I would urge you to go to Shetland, actually, and look what they've done about super fast broadband in Shetland. It's fantastic. And it isn't the fact that some people have access, they do, some people obviously still don't have access to super fast, but the people that do, one of the biggest challenges is if someone is wanting to purchase something online from, say, an artist somewhere in the north of Shetland, the problem isn't about purchasing online, it's about getting that product delivered safely to the individual wherever that is. So therefore there are other challenges within which is something that we are looking at too. On the issue of skills, and this is something I think you are also concerned about as a parliament, I mean, 1 in 10 schools in Scotland still don't have a computer science teacher. We need to look at digital skills seriously. I'm really pleased that Scottish Government has put money into Coder Dojo programmes and trying to make sure coding is accessible. And if any of you are interested, I think there's a Coder Dojo on at Glasgow Science Centre this Saturday. I'm taking my son to it, so I'm well aware of it, and I think that's a fantastic initiative. But on the mindset issue, it's about seeing things through that digital prism, and we still have to ensure that our small businesses have all of those parts to that, whether it's accessing superfast broadband or ensuring that the skills to be able to deliver on that digital world that we're all existing within.
We've got Ian Hudghton.
Just very briefly on broadband and TTIP, let's not wait for TTIP before we resolve the broadband problems because, frankly, I think we would do better to concentrate on resolving the broadband problems, in which case it would be done long before a TTIP comes into effect, I suspect.
Okay. Ian Duncan, do you want to come back in on the digital question?
If I may, again, Mr. Manock, you again have put your finger on one of the bigger issues, I think, affecting Scotland. I've just commissioned a report into what I'm calling taking the single market to the edge. It's being authored by a gentleman who may be familiar to Donald McInnes, former chief executive of Scotland Europa. It's to look at what are the barriers now to making sure that this 15% who are in the shadows are absolutely getting the full benefit from the single market. Because frankly, you should be able to access a single market as easily from Stornoway as you can from downtown Silesia. Anybody in the EU needs to benefit from being in the EU, otherwise it's just not fair. So again, there's European money out there, and I know that the Scottish Parliament has taken an active interest in getting that money into the areas to try and ensure that we are well connected. Because to my mind, and I've said this many times to colleagues in Brussels, I would rather be sitting in Lerwick doing my job than sitting in Brussels doing my job, and there's no reason why on many occasions that can't be done, because if we can get the IT to work, frankly, you want to be looking at on beautiful landscapes, not on the concrete jungles. So I think more people would want to be in those parts of Scotland, frankly, than many of the other grey parts of Europe.
Before you take yourself away to Stornoway, I'm going to go to David Coburn. Mr. Coburn.
Well, I have someone who's set up an internet company, which has been quite reasonably successful. I'm very keen on internet going all the place. I agree with my friend Ian Hudghton here that we should not be waiting for TTIP for that to happen. It should have happened a long time ago, and I regret the fact that that we're not doing that. When you see the Chinese are going to put somebody on Mars, we can't even get our broadband sorted out. So I'm very keen on that. As for Mr. Malik being also mischievous about businessmen and businesswomen, well, as far as I'm concerned, mankind, we don't discuss womankind. Mankind is a genus, and woman is a special sort of a man. So as far as I'm concerned,
we are more likely to say human.
I was taught English at Glasgow High School, and quite frankly, I don't do political correctness, but I have many women business friends. Well, I'm sorry. May I just say that I have many business women who are friends of mine, and I've met many times Michelle Moan, one of Ian's new peers, perfectly fabulous example of Scottish business person, whatever you like to call it. But I think all this pathetic, childish, sort of schoolboy nonsense is really a bit above you, sir.
I think you've made your views perfectly clear.
Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Yeah, three related questions, if I may. Firstly, what are the prospects for the Prime Minister's proposals being successfully negotiated? And is there a formal role for Scotland in those negotiations, or the devolved administrations within the UK? Thirdly, obviously we've seen major shocks to the EU and to European solidarity over the last few months with the refugee crisis from Syria and last weekend's outrage in Paris, which clearly has created a threat to security, or there's certainly a widespread perception of a threat to security in this country and throughout Europe. And what impact do you think this will have on fundamental principles of the European Union, like freedom of movement for peoples, and obviously the knock-on effect of that on the referendum? The referendum in the UK can't be held in isolation from international affairs. So I'm sorry, that's three quite big questions, but I think they're fairly fundamental as to where Europe is going to go.
I think given your first question is about the Prime Minister's negotiations, I think we will go to the Prime Minister's man in the EU. That's Ian Duncan. Not in Stornoway yet.
Only a matter of time if I answer this question wrongly, I assure you. I would say right now, as not to surprise you, I think they will be successful. I think a lot of the assumption is that it all must be done very publicly. You must see it out there. In fact, Britain, the UK government, of all persuasions over the last 20 years, has been very successful at something that's often not spoken about, soft power, its ability to work behind the scenes. That's been very successful. So in the answer to the first question, yes, I believe that will be successful. Should there be a formal role for Scotland? Yes, I believe there should be. I think that the four asks which are now in written form are important not just to Scotland or to England or to Wales or Northern, they're important to everybody. And so frankly, there should be a formal and informal component to that. And I would hope, and I do believe, that the Scottish Government is in dialogue with the UK Government over a number of these issues. As to the question of the wider issues of security, I know that Mr. Ingram is not implying this, but it certainly came across that there was a linkage between the refugee crisis and the atrocities in Paris. And I'm always very loath to see that linkage made so strongly. I think that the people who are fleeing from the terror in Syria are fleeing from those very self-same people. I would say that very strongly. And I'm sure you agree with that, so I'm not trying to make anything out of that. I think we are all on the same page when it comes to those who have been through the horrors that are unfolding in Syria and elsewhere. I have concern about the direction of travel within the EU just now, mostly because of the unilateral actions of a number of member states, which I think have undermined that solidarity. So, for example, I think the behaviour of the German government has caused a number of tensions, because they have made very clear policy statements and then changed those policy statements, and in the bygoing created significant problems for those member states lying between themselves and the Aegean Sea. And the suspension of the Dublin Convention in all but name, I think, was an unfortunate statement to make, particularly when shortly thereafter they reinstated it, in encouraging so many people to come to Germany and then beginning to say, but actually now we've reached that point where we want to not encourage people to come. The setting up the quota system to move people around Europe, but discovering in fact that although we're talking about tens of thousands that should be moved, less than 300 have been moved. I think the EU has not been awash with common sense or solidarity, and I think that's a real shame, because I think this is a humanitarian issue, and we are falling short, and I think we should all be doing more to address these issues. And again, the UK government putting so much money into the area around Syria is doing good. I think that is important. I know that our parties all stand in support of those who are fleeing terror. And I know that we stand in solidarity with Paris and indeed with Beirut and so on, for those who are experiencing that terror so close to home. So I think right now the EU has to do better. But again, I think that I don't think the challenge is people's desire to do better. I think it's their ability to understand how to make it better or try to drive it forward. And I think that is a challenge. And I think the fact there's not been a simple solution tells us there probably isn't a simple solution.
I think Mr. Duncan, Mr. Ingram wasn't making a connection between the refugee crisis and some of the serious concerns we've seen over the weekend. What I think he was suggesting, and he'll agree with me if not, is that both these things have had a serious knock on the EU's ability to do its job, and whether that would then have an impact on a subsequent referendum in an in-and-out situation. Is that right, Mr.
Yeah, sorry. I think you're absolutely right. I didn't want to put words or take words out of Mr. Ingram's mouth, just to be clear. I think the sad fact is that the events unfolding in Europe just now are having an impact across not just the UK, but across the whole of the EU. And I think support for EU institutions is falling, again, not just here at home, but abroad. We're seeing trust in the European institutions and indeed in the member states' leaderships deteriorating. I think that is due to the seeming inability to get a solution that works and holds. And I think conducting a referendum against that backdrop is not ideal. That is very true. If I were being frank and perhaps really giving you more information than I anticipated, I think by now the UK government had thought that the serious discussions in Europe would be around the UK's role with the EU and how reform can take place. But I think we've witnessed over the last year, both with the financial crises unfolding, the Greek situation, and now indeed with the migration question, that the top issue on the agenda often isn't that serious question of the UK's role. There are many other serious tensions now that require serious solutions, and the EU is just a bit bedraggled. It hasn't got enough capacity or time to solve all of the problems, and I think that is a serious worry, particularly as we do begin to conduct what will be a referendum campaign.
Mr. Mr. Ingram, does that answer?
Well, I'd like to hear the other.
I just wanted to check. Mr. Coburn, do you want to come in on that question?
Certainly. Start with the first question. Mr. Cameron, well, he's asked for nothing. I mean, I think it was Bernard Jenkins said, one of his backbenchers, senior one, said, is that it? Is that all you're wanting? Well, he doesn't want very much, and he can't get very much. Merkel's already told him he's not getting the thing. Hollande said the same thing. What he's asked for, they're nothing. It's just will-o'-the-wisp sort of nonsense. So that's a joke. He won't get any changes. He's doing this to cover his embarrassment, that's all. He's a Europhile, and he's leading a party of people who are anti-European Union. So he's got a problem. He's trying to persuade them by, oh, look, we've made these changes. Nonsense. He can't get anything. To the Scottish involvement, well, I believe Scotland should put its tuppence worth in. The Parliament here, people are wise people here, should be saying what they want to say. But, of course, I don't think they're going to get any better luck at changing the European way of doing things than Mr. Cameron's going to have any difference doing it. So I think this is more of a federal system in the United Kingdom, and I believe that that's probably a question for Westminster to handle. But, of course, I'm sure that Nicola Sturgeon won't be shy in sticking her tuppence worth in, will she, Ian? So I'm sure she'll say what she thinks. And thirdly, on the problems of immigration, it is a serious problem. We've got people, an exodus, I think is the best way of describing it, people coming across Europe. It's very sad. It's appalling. There are some refugees from Syria, I'm sure, among them. But the vast majority of them, I think, are economic migrants. I don't blame them. If I were living in one of those awful countries, I'd be getting my family together and coming over. But the problem is, it's not possible for us just to have unlimited numbers of people coming over. We have a housing shortage in Scotland, we have unemployment in Scotland and in Great Britain as a whole. We can't just have mass migration. The Germans are already having problems. This Madam Merkel made a very stupid remark, which I think she's now regretting, saying, let's have everybody in. It's nonsense. I have been saying repeatedly in the European Parliament, you can look at all the clips on YouTube if you like, I've been saying repeatedly that we should be setting up good camps on the Turkish-Syrian border, and they should be properly run. Now, the British government's giving more money than any other government. I'd like to see the European Union getting a bit more of its own money out. I don't want to see the European Union doing it itself. I'd rather the nation state did it individually, because once the money ends up in the sticky fingers of the European Union, it'll disappear into an oubliette and never be seen again. So I'd rather see the money being given by the nation states to setting up good camps. I'd also like to see the Kuwaitis and the Saudis getting their fingers out of their pockets and producing some money, because they've got pots of it. And they're not doing anything for their co-religionists. And I think that is a disgrace. There is no reason we can't have good camps there. And then once the situation has been resolved in Syria, these people can go back home again. But it seems that I wonder if there's a tendency people want to try and cause more trouble by bringing more refugees in and cause trouble. Now, we have security problems with this as well. I think we're all aware of what can happen. I talked to the First Minister about that when we had our European members of Parliament meeting with her in Brussels. I said to her, you are responsible for the people of Scotland in the same way the Prime Minister in Great Britain is responsible as well for the security. And, if we must make sure that we keep good race relations in this country, we have good relations in Scotland because we have a number of people that work and we have integrated them into the country. And I think that if you just have mass immigration without integration, that's where you have the problems. That's where you have the terrible problems in the banlieue de Paris, all around Paris suburbs, which is appalling. You have ghettos there, which are quite terrifying. And I've been to these places, and I wouldn't like to go there at night or even during the day. Some of them are utterly terrifying. And Europe has a massive social problem because these people are being imported into Europe and they are not getting jobs. If you have lots of young men running around with no jobs, they're going to get into trouble and they feel they're rejected by society and they go and join things like jihad or whatever. I think we have to be sensible about this. There's only so many people we can keep in the country. We have to maintain our social security, our hospitals. We need to make sure taxes are a reasonable rate. And at the moment, we've got a lot of soldiers who are not being housed. Now, that's a disgrace that we should be handling. So, until we've solved the problem in Scotland of social housing and the problem of of unemployment, and I don't see anybody around this table has a miracle cure for that, then I think we're best not having mass immigration here. We should be trying to get these people housed, and preferably in the first country they come to. I don't, you know, it seems strange. If I were a migrant, I'd be happy to go to Turkey because I'm safe in Turkey. I don't necessarily want to plough right all the way across Europe or jump into a leaky boat to get somewhere else, unless it's obviously to improve the lot of my family. And I don't blame them, but it's not right we should do it. We've got to think of our own people too.
Catherine, do you want to come in there?
If I can take your last question first. Tomorrow there's a meeting of justice ministers. I think it's an emergency meeting. There's five aspects on the agenda. The first is about the temporary suspension of Schengen for 10-20 days. That can be done under terrorism measures. The second issue is about the spread of weapons across the European Union. The third is about the extension of passenger name records. Now, at the moment, that debate is being had to do with airlines. Tomorrow's agenda, the agenda will talk about passenger name records for people travelling by rail. So that's got implications for the Eurostar, the TGV. The fourth aspect will be on intelligence sharing. We saw that the Belgian authorities had some of those suspects and never shared the intelligence with the French authorities. That's so tragic. And we see that really has to be much more on the agenda about member states sharing intelligence. And the fifth is about external borders and what we do. So that's on the agenda tomorrow at the Council. And I think we should watch what happens there. I was really touched actually walking into the Scottish Parliament today to see that book of condolences with both flags. And in the Parliament on Tuesday, we had a minute's silence in the chamber where staff and MEPs gathered together. We sang the Marseillaise and we heard from the President of the Parliament. We had a minute's silence, and then it was finished with a very moving lady playing the solo violin with the Ode to Joy. It's touched us all, and I think that we don't know what will happen next, but we do know that tomorrow these issues are being discussed.
Mr. Hudghton, Catherine, I know that your time is very, very tight. Are you okay for another few minutes?
Yeah.
Because I'll bring in Mr. Hudghton, and I've got a final question from Anne. Mr. Hudghton.
back to the questions in order. I mean, I don't think we have time to go in fully, perhaps, to such a wide range of deep and difficult topics. But Mr. Cameron's prospects of success, well, I wouldn't be surprised if he comes back in some months with a document that he claims to be a successful answer to the slightly vague set of demands that have been made up to now. And that's not because of anything other than what I was referring to earlier, that if a member state goes into a discussion with partner member states in a reasonably constructive fashion, then usually there is a willingness to compromise and to meet the concerns of individual member states. So that's the way it works. Did we have to do it this way and have a referendum on the alleged outcome of this? I don't think so. We could have made significant improvements over decades if we had had a more constructive attitude on the part of successive UK governments over decades. Should Scotland have a role? I'm glad to hear Ian Duncan say that he thinks Scotland should have a formal role in this process. It's a pity that Scotland and the other devolved administrations weren't consulted about the terms of the so-called demands. If that may change now that we know what they are, then I would welcome that. But up to now, as far as I'm aware, Scotland hasn't been formally involved by the UK or anyone else. And certainly would hope that given the particular interests that we have, that that will change. The catastrophic events in Paris over the weekend and the aftermath of that, of course, it's leading to a significant number of issues necessarily being discussed at European level between governments. And I think Catherine made a good point there that there is an intergovernmental role here, because the EU doesn't actually have a unified police force. It has sharing arrangements, which it would seem have not been working as well as they might in recent times. And that's certainly a wake-up call that requires the member states to get together and look at how better to share intelligence on matters and to track the movements of people who come to the attention of intelligence services, definitely. Will there be an impact on free movement? Well,
what the terrorists want is to disrupt the freedoms and the way of life that is in fact a part of being in the European Union and each of its member states. And of course we have to take I think precautions to make sure that we don't have many more of these kind of attacks, but I would hope that we don't end up with some kind of knee-jerk reaction driven by people like Mr. Coburn and his viewpoints that attack the fundamental freedoms that we enjoy, while of course understanding completely that we need to back up these freedoms with security and intelligence and the kind of cover that perhaps may have broken down in the run-up to the Paris attacks.
Okay, thank you. I'm really, really tight for time. So I've got a final question from one of our committee members, Anne McTaggart.
Convener, it's just following on, and good morning still, good morning panel. Following on from Adam Ingram's points there, it's about the relationship of our other member EU member states. How will the Prime Minister's negotiations affect other states in the European Union, and will they only affect the UK's terms of membership?
Mr. Coburn, do you want to come in there?
Not quite sure what you're driving at. Can you just be more specific?
The negotiations that are happening just now, what's been requested, do they affect any other member state?
I think, if you want my opinion, affect the entire United Kingdom if we leave the European Union. European Union. If we leave the European Union, there's going to be a lot of problems for the European Union because they won't have British money to squander. So they will have problems and they may have to actually do some reformation. I think it's going to take something catastrophic like that before they even consider any sort of reform. I don't think it would affect other members particularly. Cameron's trying to, or so he claims, get these changes made, but none of them are actually meaningful. One of them, ever closer union. Well, that's just a load of words. It doesn't mean anything. It's just blather. There's no serious reform he's trying to make, except that, saying that we don't want to be affected by the euro and all this lark. Well, quite frankly, if we vote to stay in the European Union, we are going to get the euro anyway, whether you like it or not. That's a fact. So, there's going to be, the minute we vote yes to the European Union, you're going to have all the Europhiles going bonkers, and they'll be going gangbusters to get the whole lot of us into the euro. And anybody who believes otherwise is being disingenuous, or they're daft, one or the other. But that's what's going to happen.
Mr. Duncan, do you want to come in at this point?
Well, I probably note that Mr. Coburn probably is the expert on blabber in one regard. I think the big issue here is, should this be exceptionalism? Should the UK be the principal beneficiary? Now, we're pushing for it, but we're not alone. I think that's the first thing. If you look at the turn of events over the recent elections across the European Union, a number of parties belonging to my own political group, which has the word reform in its title, have been successful. So the recent election, again in Poland, was won by a member of the European Conservative and Reformist group. You find the same situation now, that our party in Finland is also in government, with Foreign Secretary of Finland was speaking yesterday at a conference I was attending. You see the same thing, the NVA in Belgium. So again, the word reform here isn't just about UK reform, and it can't be, shouldn't be. You can't have exceptionalism that's like that. Second thing is, what then and how impact does it have? Well, at the moment, for example, the Eurozone versus the non-Eurozone question. Well, we're not the only people not in the Eurozone. There are many other member states who have, Denmark has itself the same clauses to remove it from that, but a number of other member states haven't joined. Do they want to join? Must they join? Because at present, the way the treaties are drafted, they must join the Eurozone. That's a commitment they make. Now, the question is it a commitment they should have to make? Do they need to make it? And should the rules within the Eurozone dictate the rules of the EU, since they're not coterminous? So that's, I think there are very clear distinctions there. If you look toward the question of the ever closer union, and it is indeed just a form of words, but then that's what treaties are. They're forms of words. The problem with ever closer union is it's often invoked by the European courts as a determinant aspect of legislation. And should it be? Need it be? No, I don't think it needs to be. I think what we've recognised is there are many benefits to the European Union, but driving forward integration at all levels and harmonisation at all levels isn't required. And that's why, again, around the table you're sitting at today, I'm sure there are many of you who would say that I think we should be doing something comparable to the rest of the EU or indeed to certain member states, but it need not be dictated by them if it runs counter to our own traditions, our own sense of democracy or anything else. So to my mind, this can't be exceptionalism. And even touching upon the more thorny issue of restrictions to benefits and so forth, my view would be the free movement of people is a core strength of the EU. I believe that. I believe that people travelling here should be able to travel for work. That doesn't cause me any issues. And I would say that most of those who are in Scotland who are, frankly, keeping many of our rural areas alive in some respects, because they are to be found now from top to bottom, they're here to work. So the benefit question is a separate benefit question, I believe, for them. And I would like, again, to think that they are bringing vibrancy to those remote and rural areas because they're needed. So to my mind right now, this is not about Britain trying to be on the edge and different from everybody else. It's actually about forming alliances with other member state governments, and we're doing that, with other groups in the Parliament, and we're doing that, to try and find ways of making the European Union better. And thus far, I've heard, apart from Mr. Coburn, who's got a very scalpel-like approach to this aspect, everyone else believes that reform is needed. This is an opportunity for that reform, whether it be Mr. Hudghton or Ms. Stihler. We all believe that reform is needed. Whether indeed reform is happening, again, it is. But a lot of it driven by Britain determining that actually the EU should do less, but do that less better. So as MEPs, we've got an 80% reduction in the amount of law going through the European Parliament. That's a good sign. We've now got a whole refit agenda. Are the laws fit for purpose? Should they be just simply churned out, or should they be actually tailored to need? And should dormant laws simply be allowed to stay on the statute books causing troubles? Now, that's already beginning to happen as a result of the pressures from the UK. That's a good thing. So I do believe that the EU will benefit from this push for reform. It's already benefiting from that push for reform.
Okay, Mr. Hudghton.
I think Ian just made a point that I made several times, that the EU is constantly evolving because it has to meet circumstances, and constructive engagement between member states and so on is happening all of the time. There's been massive change in the time that I've been involved as an MEP, for example, without having this kind of alleged crisis and need to reform our terms of membership, I think was used in the question. Well, this is not about terms of membership as such in the strict application of that term, in my view, because the terms of membership are set out in the treaties, and there's no one is here thinking or asking, even David Cameron is not asking for treaty reform of the terms of membership. The EU can only do what the treaties specify, and if the EU wanted to do something additional that is not already specified in the treaties, it would have to change the treaties by unanimity, which means that no member state can be forced to do something new by this alleged entity that is the EU, that some people think takes over and sort of does things on its... Well, it does. It is true to add...
Can you stick to answering the question, please?
To add competences to the European Union's range thereof, it is true. That is the position that we're in. Do the four demands affect other member states? Well, they might to some extent. Depends exactly what the outcome is. It's not exactly clear in either David Cameron's letter or in the four summarised aims exactly what it is he's looking for. And I suspect that the outcome will be some sort of compromise that the other member states are prepared to sign up to, but it might simply be the other member states signing up to say, well, you do that if you want.
Ms. Stihler, you're going to get the final comments of the day, because we're really running over our
time. I'll be very, very short. I think in answer to your question, Anne, about how this will impact on other members, it will be determined by the negotiation. So we have to see how that will go. We know the four asks now, we've seen the letter, and we will obviously see the responses from the member states, I would think, to that letter. And as we go forward, we'll have the December Council, and then we'll see if the deal is done in the December Council, then we might be clearer to knowing a date for the referendum. So there's a lot to play for.
Yeah. Thank you. Can I thank you very much? I know we ran over our time this morning and you'll realise we could have explored lots and lots of areas. Can I thank you all for giving your time to the committee this morning? Can I thank you, Ian, for buzzing in from London? Yeah. It's good to have you. We need to get you in front of committee again, sir, but we'll do that maybe the next time. We're obviously working on all of these areas and we'll continue to work on them and we'll keep in close contact with you. But on behalf of the committee this morning, if I can thank you all and wish you well in all of your endeavours in Europe in the coming months. Thank you very much. Okay, I'm going to go straight into agenda item 2 because we are now very tight for time. Agenda item 2 is our Brussels Bulletin, so I'm looking for any queries, questions, points of clarity. Rod.
Convener, I'm obviously grateful to the Bulletin for outlining one of the matters we've just been referring to, which is the UK Government's proposals for reform. I wondered if the Spice or someone could provide a bit more information on the question of the rules which apply across the European Union to migrants claiming benefits when they begin working. It kind of enhance our understanding of the debate in relation to that.
Okay, thank you. Is that something we could do? Yeah, definitely something we could do, that comparator. Like a table of comparison.
Well, yeah. Any information is better than none.
Okay.
On the point, yeah.
Thank you. Anything else on the Brussels Bulletin? Well, no. Rod?
One other point. I kind of read with interest the comments in relation to the review of the Birds and Habitats Directive. It's my understanding that so far the UK government has been rather silent on it. So I just... we obviously could have asked Mr. Duncan about that this morning, but we covered a lot of grounds. But I'm grateful for kind of further information on the UK government's position on that, if any is obtainable.
Okay. Yeah. Anne.
Really just to highlight, it's not a question, it's just to highlight under the employment skills and education section, the Erasmus Plus. It's a wow. From Scotland, there were 151 successful applications, which was super. Yeah, just to highlight that. Sorry, Convener.
I think the NUS did a lot of work when their Scot Goes Global campaign to get as many young people to sign up as possible because traditionally it was very, very low. But it's a good step forward. Absolutely.
Brilliant.
Well noted. Well noted indeed. Anything else on the Brussels Bulletin? No. Well, can we share the Brussels Bulletin with the relevant committees? Maybe the specific committees on, maybe the Welfare Reform Committee on Rod's question, the Rural Committee on the Rural Habitats, and maybe Education Committee on the points that you make. Yeah, can we do that? Okay, well, if you're happy to do that, then we can move on to agenda item 3, which we will take in private. So I now suspend committee to go into private. Thank you.